All right, welcome to video number two, in which we explore a typical data analysis workflow with the Tidyverse, and we wrangle different kinds of data, and we also learn a bit about factors. One small little note before we get started. You might wonder why I have this really detailed script and also the videos. Well, I think the script is actually really good to work through and to look up stuff after the fact. But the video also helps because I try to be vocal about how to pronounce the code, because code can be a lot of symbols, so I try to be vocal about how to pronounce it in your head so that you can build up a mental model, and it makes working with the code more like talking to a helpful friend. So without further ado, let's jump straight into our studio. And I pretty much have the same setup as last time, but I want to go over a couple of settings here under Tools and Global Options that I would like you to set, and that is under General. You uncheck Restore our data into Workspace at Startup and Save Workspace to our data on exit. Why would we want to do that? Saving sounds actually quite nice. The reason is we want our code and our raw data that we have to be the sole source of truth. And if R saves what we did last time in some environment variable like our data, we start relying on this, but we want our code to be able to produce everything. So our code is basically the product, because if we have the code, we can produce the plots and the objects. But if we only have the objects, we can lose them. Another setting is here under code and saving. And if you change this to UTF-8, to be the default for saving, it just makes it easier if you are working on Windows and some other people are working on Mac or on Linux, for example. It just unifies everything. Like German umlauts or something like that makes can be a pain. Okay. More workflow stuff, because if we are, for example, saving something, you might wonder, how does R know where to save something? Let's create a little example. I will use the file.create function to just create a test file. Test.txt test, for example. I run this. It created a file. So where did it create a file? And the directory, the folder R is currently working in, is called the working directory. We can get the current working directory using the function getwd. And it tells me, it's in my home folder. On Windows, it will probably be your documents folder. So if I look in there now using my file manager, you can see the test.test file, but there's nothing in there, it's just a file. And that might be quite unhelpful because we don't want all our files in one folder, especially not in our home folder. So now the next logical question is, okay, how do we change the working directory? Say we are working on an analysis and we want to set the working directory to where the analysis is and where our data is. And the following thing I'm showing you is something I actually don't want you to use. I will show you a better way afterwards. But just for sake of completeness, there's also setwd, where you can give a file path, say home Yannick, and then desktop. If I run this now, and let me execute file.create now, and if I look in my desktop folder, now we have the test file on our desktop. But there's a problem here, because if you have this in your script, the script will only work for people who are called Yannick and who are also happen to be working on their desktop, which is not that many people. So we want our script to be working for everybody, which is why we use something more clever than absolute file path, which is file paths that start at like the root. On Windows, there would be something like C:// I think, and Windows uses slashes the other way around. But in R and most programming languages, you actually use slashes this way around. So what we don't want is these absolute file paths, which start at the root. We want relative file paths, which start at some folder and then navigate from there. And we want this relative file paths and these files to actually move with the folder our analysis in. So let me show you how to do this. We can use RStudio projects. Notice up here, it says project none. We are not in a project. So let's change that. We want to create a new project. And let's create a new project in a new directory. Just new project. And let me create it on the desktop. And I give it a name and call it lecture 2. Now it will close the other studio session and open the new project. Notice now we have this lecture2.r project file in our folder. I can also show you on the desktop that we now have this folder lecture 2 and we have this r project file. Now this r project file, the only thing it does is when r finds this file, it knows, okay, this is supposed to be our working directory. If I run getwd in here, this is the working directory. And if I, let's go back to the desktop, if I move this folder and send it to you, for example, it will still work because the working directory will automatically be in this folder. So a typical project would, for example, have a new folder in here where I put my raw data and maybe some other folders where I put some scripts. But for now, I create a data folder that makes everything a bit cleaner for later. Now, one thing I didn't tell you about the document format we used last week and we will be using today again, which is R Markdown. I didn't tell you that in R Markdown documents by default, the working directory is, when you knit it, is automatically the folder where this document lives. So if I create one here, it technically doesn't need the project, but if you use scripts and R Markdown and all that, I recommend just always create a project, and then you can also easier find the different projects you're currently working on, which is a handy feature. And you can open up your project and you have all the files the way you left them. And speaking of files, let's actually create a new R Markdown document for today's code. Okay. And just delete the example code. And our first topic is actually still in RStudio. I want to show you how to customize RStudio so you can feel right at home. Let's save that because I have a habit of pressing Ctrl S to save. And now it shows up here in the file panel. If you go to Tools and Global Options, you can change the appearance of RStudio. I have a bunch more themes installed through another package, which is called RS Themes. But you can change them here. And then you simply hit OK or Apply. You can also change the font and font size. If you want to change where the different panels are, you can do that here in the pane layout. All right, the next topic is just how a typical data analysis workflow looks like. So I have this picture here from Hedy Wickham's R for Data Science. And it is a nice flowchart where we can see the first step is usually to import your data. Then you often need to somewhat tidy it. And we will get into this idea of what's tidy data next week. And then you do some transformations like adding new columns to your data, filtering, selecting columns. You build some visualizations, you model, like fitting a model that tries to predict new data based on the current data, and then you communicate your findings. And we will do importing today, we will transform, we will visualize today. We won't do any modeling today. And tidying we will also mostly leave to next week. But because we're using our Markdown, we are already sort of in a communication ready format, so we are definitely communicating today. So first things first, reading in data. And the package for this is called the readr package, which is also part of the tidyverse. So we actually don't need to load it explicitly. We just load the whole tidyverse using library tidyverse. Oh, tidyverse, there we go. All right. It gives us a little warning that some methods have been overwritten by dbblyr, which is for tibble lazy and tibble, which is just how these tibbles that we saw last week are printed in the console when they're coming from a different database and we're not working with databases. So in general, you can ignore this warning. Okay, but in order to read in data, you will of course need to download the data. So let's go over how we are doing this. If I pull up the course website, you will see this little icon here, which is the OctoCat from GitHub. Let me full screen this. This is where you find all the code, but you can also look into the individual lectures. Today we are lecture 2, and this is where you also find the data. So there's a bunch of options to download this. We can go back to this folder of the whole website with all the code and go here to code and then download it as a zip file. And in there, then you will find all the lectures with all the data. There's some more options. We can actually download the data straight from R. We can go into this data folder and then, for example, let's use the gapminder CSV file. I click on it. It will display a preview, but we actually want the raw file. So I click on raw. And now I can copy this link up here, which is the link to the raw data. And if I now use download.file and paste in this link and also tell it where the file should go. So we want to have it under data and then call it gapminder.csv. Now I execute this and download the file. If I look into data, here we have the CSV file. And CSV stands for comma separated values. So we have these different columns all separated by comma. Now what we can do, if I just close this here and insert a new code chunk, is to read in the data using a function from reader called read underscore. So all the reader functions start with read underscore. It's nice to remember, read underscore CSV. RStudio's auto-completion helps us here because we can just type dot, which stands for the current directory. And then we want something in the current directory. So we use this slash, forward slash, and then we toggle the auto-completion using tab or control enter. And now we get a list of the folders and files in here. And now we can read in our dataset using read_csv. We can see our dataset contains information about the life expectancy, the total population, and the cross domestic product per capita for a bunch of years, and I think 142 countries. In order to actually use this dataset, what we do is save it to a variable. Let's call it gapminder and assign this to the gapminder variable. Now, reader tells us a little bit about what it assumed the columns of our data to be. So it guessed that country is of type character, so it's text, continent as well, and the rest is all double, so these are numbers. And we could also tell this directly to read CSV using the call types argument, but mostly it guesses just fine. Now the rest that follows is actually just a bunch of cool tricks and some things that might make importing the data harder. So the first trick is Read CSV can also just take a link. So we can just paste this hyperlink in here. And we don't even need to download it first. It will download it automatically. And then we could now save it to a file. So let's call it my data. My data. And now we could save it as an RDS file, write RDS, which is the write function from reader. So reader also has a bunch of write functions. And the equivalent from base R would just be save RDS. But I like to stay in the tidyverse, so everything looks nice and fits together. Write RDS takes an R object, my data, and it takes a file path, mydata.rds, for example. And now if I look into the file, there's this dataset, which we can load using read.rds. What I will do now is I'm actually going to cheat. I will actually move to the project I have for the course already, which is for the course website. Because I already have all the data downloaded there, so I don't need to download it again. Okay, so gapminder.csv is a normal CSV file. If you just look into it, it's separated by comma. However, if you got your CSV file, maybe from a German Excel user, it might look a little bit different. Let's look at gapminder CSV 2. It has the same file extension, it's also called read.csv, but we don't have commata, we have semicolons. This is because in German, commata are used to denote decimal places, like the dot in English. So, for some reason, German file people decided that German CSVs would be semicolon separated. But luckily, we have the function read CSV2, which is like a secondary version, and this can deal with this CSV2 version, and it works just as well. If we don't want to open the file by hand, we can always use read lines, which basically reads the raw text files. So let me look at one example. As data, gapminder read tsv.txt, and I just call it text file, because well, now we will look into how it looks. We don't want to look like print out the whole text file. Let's set the argument nmax for how many lines we want. Let's look at 3 lines. Now we see this backslash t, and backslash denotes that some special characters coming. And backslash t is like the raw text encoding for a tab, which is like the button on the left of your keyboard. So this is TSV, stands for text separated values, but sometimes people only put the text file ending on there and you need to figure out what it is. So we can actually read it in as a real table using read TSV. Data gapminder TSV, and it works, that's good. Now read TSV and read CSV and all that are just a special case of read delim for delimiter. And we can specify, well, let's first specify a file that we want to read in. And the file we want to read in, I think I called obscure file. It has the TSV file extension, but this is actually a lie, as we will see later on. Because if we try to read it in with read delim and the tab separator, we will only get one column. And now we notice, oh, Maybe our colleague did something wrong and thought TSV stands for tilde separated files, and they are all separated by this tilde character. We could have seen that if we just read it in like the first couple of lines. But now that we know, okay, it's not actually a tab character, it's separated by tildes, now we can read it in. So sometimes you just have to look at the raw text file using your favorite text editor or just RStudio. Notice that all these files, for example the TSV file here, they all start with the headers in the first row, but this will not always be the case. So let's look at some data which is a bit more messy. It starts with two lines which are not actually headers of our columns. So if we were to read this in normally, I would be a bit confused. We write read CSV data and we want gapminder messier. And now you can also pause the video if you want and see if you can figure out what argument we need to give to read CSV to read it in, but I will do so now. I use the auto-completion to toggle through the different arguments, or I could also look at the help page. And there I see there's an option called skip. Number of lines to skip before reading in data. And I know that the first two lines we don't want. So I say skip equals 2. And now everything works just fine. Sometimes there might also be some data in the end that you don't want, not in these examples, but you could also set n max for the maximum number of records to read. So if you want to only read in the first 5 lines, this is what we would get. Now, after having read in our data, we move on to wrangling our data. So wrangling is this umbrella term for, say, creating new columns for data, selecting columns, filtering our data, or shaping our data in different forms, all that stuff, which is the responsibility of the dplyr. Dplyr package, which stands for data plyr, which is this tool in here in the logo. And the functions that dplyr provides are sometimes also called verbs. And the main ones we have are select for selecting columns, filter for filtering our data based on some condition, mutate for changing or adding new columns, arrange for arranging the rows in our data, and then summarize to summarize our data. And then there's group by, which could be considered an adverb because it doesn't actually do anything by itself, but it changes the way the other verbs work. And then there's the pipe, which ties everything neatly together, and we will talk about this when it comes up. So, without further ado, let's go wrangling. Let's take the gapminder variable that we assigned the gapminder dataset when we first imported the CSV file. And what I want to show you first is the select function. So we type select, and we already have dplyr loaded because it's part of the tidyverse. And the first argument is the data. And the data we want to give it is gapminder. If you don't give it anything, it will not select nothing. So as some more arguments, it takes any number of columns to select. So let's say we want to have the country and the year and the population. And now I run this and I get basically a subset of our data frame or tuple, which is only having the country, year and population column. Now you might be wondering why we don't need quotation marks around these. Because remember, last time we were subsetting something with their names, we had to use quotation marks. Say I have this vector where we have the first element, which is 1, and the second argument called second, not argument, element. second element, which contains a 2, and has the names first and second. So I want to get the first element. I need to write first, otherwise this won't work. But in select, or in general in dplyr and a lot of parts of the tidyverse, we don't need to do that. This is because of a concept called data masking, or quasi-quotation, depending on the exact specification. But in general, it means the select function and the dplyr functions know about the data we put in. So when we type in names afterwards here, it will first look in the data for these names as names of the data before it looks somewhere else. So we can use this just like we would use variable names. Outside of the data frame, these do not exist. Country doesn't exist. However, country is a column of the gapminder package. Whoa, that's that's all the countries. So because of data masking, we don't need the quotation marks, and this is where the select function will look for these names. There's also a bunch more really cool ways to select columns. And if we look into the help page for select, we get a bit more information. For example, there's an overview of the selection features in here, like everything to select all the columns, or some tidy select helpers like starts with or ends with. For example, let's select from the gapminder package all columns that starts with let's actually look at the gapminder package over here. So let's select all columns that start with C or CO, which is those two. Or we could also select all columns where the following condition is true, is.numeric. And this would display all number columns. We can also, if I look at the complete data set again by highlighting it and executing it with Control Enter, say we want all columns from year to, using the colon, from year to GDP per, and now it selected these columns. And just like the other subsetting, we can still use indices. And I also changed the order here, just because I can. Next up, after having selected columns, we want to select, or in this case, it's called filter the rows. And we want to filter them based on some conditions. In this cute example by Alison Horst, they have some data and then some conditions. For example, in this data, they are selecting everything where the type is otter, which is these ones, and also where the side is equal to bay. Oh, and I should mention, these double colons indicate the package that a certain function comes from. So if you are not loading the whole package, you can also refer to functions from a package that you have installed using package name, then double colon, and then the name. So you don't need to always load the whole package. But in the case of the tidyverse, we are using so many functions from there, we almost always load it. Right, jumping in, I create a new code chunk using Ctrl-Alt-I, and I want to filter on the gapminder dataset. Let me remind myself what is in there. And let us introduce some conditions, like, for example, we want the year to be smaller, so less than 2006. Or let's say you want to have it greater or equal than 2006. Which apparently there is no year 2006, only 2007. Or let us say we want to look for a certain country. Now we need, what we need is to have something being equal, and for this we need double equal. This is because in most programming language a single equal is used to assign values or to assign parameters and functions. So we need the double equal to ask for equality instead of setting something. And what we want is say New Zealand. And now we only get New Zealand. We can chain these, we can filter for more things, like for example, we only want New Zealand where the year is equal to 2007, which is only one row of data. We can, instead of using this and, we can also, so comma and and are equivalent in this function, but let's say you want or, which means we select everything where the country is New Zealand or everything where the year is 2007, which means we will get all years from New Zealand and the year 2007 from all other countries. Next up is creating new columns. Let's look at our data set again. And for this, we need the function mutate. So mutate again takes, like all dplyr, verbs as the first argument, the data. And you will see why this is handy. That is always the first argument in a second. And then it takes a bunch of statements where we create new columns. For example, we have this GDP per capita, and we have the population, the total population. So if we combine this, we can create a new column which contains the total GDP. So GDP would be equal to the population times the GDP per capita. And now, oh, it didn't fit in here, but we have this little error. We have a new column which contains the total GDP for all rows. Now what this doesn't do is change the original data, which is a common theme. These functions only take some input and produce some output. So if we want to change what we have saved in our gapminder variable, what we do is assign the result of this computation back to gapminder. And now if we look at our gapminder variable, we have the new column here. Mutate can not only create new columns, it can also change columns. So if this name here already exists, it would change this. Another aspect of this is it works because of this idea of vectorization. We don't have to say take every single row and multiply it with the corresponding element in the GDP column. No. It knows, okay, this is a vector and this is a vector, so it multiplies the elements on the correct positions. The next section is a bit of an interlude. What I want to do is look at how this sort of works behind the magic, because, well, using the tidyverse and dplyr can feel a bit magical because it, well, just works. So let's look at how we do this without packages, using only base R functions. You don't necessarily have to know this or do this, but it can come in handy. And especially when things don't go as planned, you want to know why things went wrong and want stronger tools to debug, so to find out what went wrong. So remember when we had a vector of numbers and we called it X, and then we assigned some names to it. This is what it looks like if we subset this vector using indices. We could get, for example, the first and second column. We could also use names, and we can use Boolean vectors. So true, for example, for the first, not the second, not the third, so false as well, and maybe true for the fourth one, which will give us these ones. We could also have created this Boolean vector in advance. So let's say, let's call it select this, and in there, instead of creating our true, false, false, true, or else, let's ask a question. For example, is x less than 20? This is what it looks like. False, true, true, false. And now if I use this Boolean vector to subset x with, I get only those where x is smaller than 20. So these questions always return a Boolean vector. Now let's move to the second dimension, because in our Gapminder example, this is a data frame, so it has two dimensions, columns and rows. Let's actually create some example data, my data, using the function tibble. And I'll put this on new line, indentation is okay. And I want x to be some numbers again. Let's look at my data. Now, what happens if we subset this two-dimensional object just like we did a vector? Well, we get columns. So we select the columns just like we did up there using select, which basically treats it like the list, which is underneath this data frame construct. But if we pass two arguments separated by comma to the square brackets, we can select rows and columns. So first we select the rows, say row 1, comma, and then the columns that we want. Let's select column 2, which is only the y1 value. Or we select multiple columns. So we need to create a vector in here, 1 and 3, for example, which is first row and second columns. We can also get some more rows, like the second and third. This is basically the combination of select and sort of filter only by indices. So how do we filter by a condition? Should the need arise to do this without dplyr? Let me copy this my data thing down here. We can look at one of these columns, for example x, and ask the question again, is it less than 20? So if I take this and I use this for subsetting the rows. So let's paste it in here, comma, and I leave this blank because I want all columns. Now I only get the rows where x is less than 20. So at first glance, the tidyverse way of doing this, which would involve both select and filter, so this would be, so say we only wanted afterwards only the first and third column. This is all one step, but in the tidyverse this would be two steps. So we would first need to take my data and filter for x smaller than 20, and then we would pass this whole thing to select. I just copied it, so I cut it, and then select the first and third. So this is a bit longer and more convoluted, you would say. There's one advantage, and it will become greater in the next examples, which is we don't need to specify that x comes from my data like we did up here. If I did only x in here, it wouldn't work because it would look for x outside of the data. Well, in this example, it would even find an x, but this might not be the x you were expecting. So this is where the pipe comes in. Oh, pipe. I previously mentioned that it will become important that the first argument to all deplier verbs is always the data. And this makes it easy to take a bunch of deplier verbs and functions and compose, chain them together, like you would chain mathematical functions. And this is what the pipe does here. It is actually a percent, and then a greater sign, and then another percent. But you don't have to type this every time. You can use the shortcut Ctrl-Shift-M. Ctrl-Shift-M. And what it does is it takes some argument from the left side. So it's an operator like plus or minus, not a regular function. Operators go between their arguments. It takes something from the left and puts it into a function on the right, like select, for example, as the first argument. So this is basically already taken by the pipe. It gets piped in here. And then we select, for example, x and y or z. And we can also put this on new line if we create more intricate steps, because, well, we can chain this all together. Afterwards, we can maybe filter, for example, for z equal to z1. So this is when the tidyverse becomes powerful. Let's go back to our actual example, the Gapminder dataset. So what I do is I pipe this to filter, for example, and I want to filter where the year is greater than, or let's say greater or equal than 2000. Another pipe, I just keep going, and then we mutate. So we create this GDP column from population times GDP per cup. Oh, and notice we also get auto-completion because the pipe puts this data set into this function, and this function knows about the data. RStudio can also help us with autocompletion in here, which is quite nice. So it can autocomplete the column names. And now I pipe it again to say select, and only select the country, year, and the GDP column that we just created. And now if I run this, in your head, you can often pronounce this pipe as something along the lines of and then. So take the Gapminder dataset and then filter for year, and then mutate, and then select these columns. What makes it quite nice to reason about your code. It is not always about how fast your code runs, it's about how fast you can think about your code. And if you can come up with some clever ideas and the code helps you think about your data, that's a big win. One final note about this topic of base R and tidyverse. Those two are not mutually exclusive. You can, of course, use whatever tool best fits the job, and sometimes a combination of both is necessary, but you can get a very, very long way with just the tidyverse and even just the simple verbs. Speaking of verbs, there's some more verbs to cover. So sometimes we not only want to select or filter columns, we want to arrange our data in some way, which is the job for the arrange function. So let's take our gapminder package and pipe it to arrange. And we want to arrange by year. And now we get everything arranged by year, which I think it previously already was. So let me introduce a little helper function. Again, I pipe this to arrange. And inside arrange, we can use this function desk for descending, which transforms a vector so we can arrange in descending order. So descending year, and now we are starting with 2007. We can also arrange by multiple columns, and the first one will be the one which is sort of most important. So if I arrange by, say, country, and within each country I arrange by year, we are first arranged by a country, so it starts with Afghanistan, starts with an A, and then we get the years in ascending order. We can keep going with our little pipeline. Say maybe you want to now select the country and the year and the population. And now what we want to do is give a new name to this population column, because pop is a bit short. And we could either do this straight in select, where we say population equals pop. Oh, and I get an error message because I have pipe in at the end and it doesn't have anything to pipe to. So if I remove this, now pop is renamed to population. I can also, if I want to not select anything, I want to keep all the columns, I just want to rename one column, I can use the rename verb. So I can rename, for example, country to all caps country for some reason. Now keep in mind, the new name comes first, which is a bit like an assignment. We're assigning this to the new name. Next up is summarize, for taking our data and condensing it down. So let's take the gapminder set and pipe it to summarize. Say we want to know what's the most current year in our data set. So let's call it last year, and it is created by the maximum of the year column. And now we only get one value. We can also create multiple summaries in one go. Say we want to also the average, we want to also know the average population across the whole data set. We take the mean of the population. And then we can also take the minimal GDP in our whole data set, just to get some examples. And now we get these three columns created up here. Now, often you don't want to just take your whole data set and squish it down. You want to summarize, but based on some other feature. Say, what if we want to know the average population across all years, the average population for each country? Or what if we want to know the highest GDP per capita, but for each country? This is what the group by adverb is for. So we take gapminder, and then we group by country. Now, this doesn't do anything yet. It only tells us, we have 142 groups because we have 142 countries. But if I now use summarize, all these summary functions will be computed within each group. So, for example, let's calculate the maximum GDP per capita, max GDP per capita. And now I get this column, max GDP per capita. Oh, it doesn't have a nice name. Let's give it a nice name. Oh, actually, let me show you something else. I assign this to a new variable. Let's call it new gapminder or gapminder summary. It also gives us this message that when you summarize, you remove one level of grouping. So let's look at the gapminder summary. We have this column, so how do we refer to it? Because it has brackets, so how do we actually use this? This is not a valid variable name, so we can't use this quasi quotation, this data masking in the normal dplyr verbs. However, I didn't tell you the whole truth when I said these names are not allowed. Basically, you can make every variable name allowed by surrounding it with the backticks, which is the same that surrounds these code chunks. So, if I want to use, for example, the dollar thing, it automatically inserts these backticks here. If I do this in dplyr and we copy and paste this here, this shouldn't work. Yes, doesn't work because it tries to compute the maximum again, but we make this a name and now it works. But don't overuse this, rather give it a new name. So let's do that while we're at it. And we can also calculate a bunch more summary functions. One function that I like to show you is we might wonder how many rows are in each group. And for this, we can use the special function n. And because it's a function, we need these brackets afterwards. These round brackets. And n will always be the size of the current group, which in this case, I think it's 12 for all of them. Group by becomes even more powerful if we group by multiple things. Let's do this per continent. And now for the complete continent of Africa or the years, in there we get the GDP per capita, the maximum GDP per capita, and also how many countries we had in this continent in this year. Notice now it also tells us we still have some groups, so if you plan on working with this data afterwards and don't want to forget that you still have groups, it is wise to use the ungroup function afterwards to make sure we don't have any group left and subsequent computations are not influenced by those groups anymore. Group by not only works on summarize, it also changes the way the other functions work. For example, if I take the gapminder package and group this by, let's say, country, we get our data set grouped by country. And now if I use filter, I could just filter by normal things like year greater than 2000, which doesn't really depend on the groups. But other things might. For example, if I calculate the maximum population, I could say Okay, give me all the rows in our data frame where per country we only get the row where the population is equal to the maximum population per country. And now we get the year where we had the highest population per country. And we can also use this in mutate. So if I group by, for example, I group by continent and by year, we get our grouped data set. And then I use mutate to add a new column. And let's add the information for each country. How much of the population this country made up of the whole continent, which is the group, for this given year. So we take the population and divide it by the sum of the population column times 100, so we get percent. So this sum will be computed within each group. So the sum will be the total population per continent, and the population without the sum function around it will just be the population per country. And now we get the percent population. A couple of minutes ago I told you about the special function n, which works inside of groups and tells us the current group size. So if we want to know how many rows we have for each group, for example, group by year, let's see what we get. Maybe we are missing some data for some years. Let's create a new column called n, which is the result of this n function. Now we have data on all 142 countries for all years. There's a faster way to do this, which is sort of a shortcut around group by and summarize using this n, which is count. Count just counts the rows, and we want to count the years, and now it gives us the same result. Now that we have wrangled this data so much, let's actually do something useful with it. Let's create a pretty visualization. So I create a new code chunk, Ctrl-Alt-I, take the gapminder set and pipe to ggplot, our trusted grammar of graphics. We want some aesthetic mapping, which is the second argument. So remember, the pipe puts this as the first argument, and the first argument of ggplot is the data. So now what we are specifying in here is the second argument, the mapping. And let's say we want on the x-axis we want the year, on the y-axis we want the life expectancy, and we want to group this by country, which is very similar to the group by up there. Group in ggplot works like assigning a color to something, except that it doesn't change the color. It just makes sure that when we have lines, for example, that we would normally have in different colors, they're not connected, even if they have the same color. And now what we add is a geom line. And let's plot this. What we see, this is very crowded. And what we can do is create a plot that is sometimes referred to as small multiples. In the grammar of graphics, these are called facets. So we can do this by facet underscore wrap. And we wrap by a feature. One common thing you see across base R and all the tidyverse is if you do something by something, we use this formula interface. And we can create a formula using the tilde symbol. So this can be translated to depends on, and it depends on the continent. or by. We first had verb by continent or depending on continent. And now we get five different smaller plots where the lines are just one continent. It is now time to introduce factors, because a common question you might ask now is, well, how do I decide the order of these small little plots? Right now it is just alphabetically, and we maybe want more control over our plots than just doing everything automatically alphabetically. And this is where factors come in. Factors encapsulate this general concept of having a vector that can only have a certain number of types of elements. For example, let's create one ourselves. I create a normal vector and I call it animals. What I assign to this is a vector of some animals, like a cat and a dog and a parrot. Of course, I shouldn't forget the quotation marks, and a whale shark, I think, should be a good fit. And we need a bear. And let's look at this vector. If I now use the function factor on the animals, it will print a bit differently. It will still say tell us, okay, we have cat, dog, parrot, whale, shark, and bear. It also tells us there's some levels. And once we have created this factor, it can only have elements which belong to one of these levels. So let's actually assign this to the animals vector so we can use it. These levels are automatically created from all the elements, so everything fits in. We could also tell it as an argument to factor what levels we want. And if something isn't in the levels, it doesn't fit in the it doesn't fit in our factor, so it will be NA. So if I only give it the levels cat and dog, everything that is not a cat or a dog doesn't work, so it will be NA, not assigned. We don't want that. Let me remove this so we can have all the animals in our factor. Now the order of our factors was done alphabetically, automatically. But if we want to change this order, we could either manually assign a complete new vector of levels and change all the levels using this factor function, or we use functions from the for cats package. And all of these functions start with fct for factor, fct. And what we want is fct relevel, where we can take a factor like animals and then say we want a couple of levels that come first. Say we want parrot followed by bear in the front, and it won't drop the other levels. There's a bunch more functions starting with fct, like for example fct reorder. If you want to reorder by some other value, the same way arrange works. But for now, let's take our gapminder dataset, pipe it straight into mutate, and then we take our continent using SCT re-level, give it the continent column, and if something isn't already a factor, it will create a factor, which in this case will happen. So what we want is we want maybe Europe and Oceania in front. Notice that factor re-level doesn't necessarily need a vector. It can just take everything as these dot 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 arguments. Dot 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 means any number of arguments is fine. Now we re-level this. It now tells us here, in very, very small, that is, it's a factor, the rest is still character. And now, if I, let me just copy and paste our code up here. So I copy this code for the plot and also make it pretty. We see it's reordered. Let me also do some more tricks, like making the lines a bit transparent by setting the alpha value. This is like how much color we get. So we make them 30% color, the rest is transparent. And one more thing, instead of plotting this straight away, let me actually save this plot to a variable. Let me call it plt, and in order to see what's in there, we print it straight away. Now it looks like nothing changed, but now we have this variable and we can execute it anytime to get our plot. We can use this to add more stuff to our plot. So we have like our basic plot, and now we can add things. For example, I want to actually change the global aesthetics. I want to say that the color is governed by the feature country. And now it takes a while because it will assign a different color to each country and will also produce a legend, which is a bit annoying because the legend just fills the whole plot. But we will fix this in a second. First, let's get some nicer colors. In the data that you downloaded, there is a file called country colors, which also came with a gapminer package, but I didn't want to have you install another package. I wanted to give all the data to you, and also that you can practice importing and downloading data. And this country colors CSV file has for each country a color code, which is the notation that you see in HTML and CSS for the web. So what we want to do is, let's call it country colors. We want to read csv dot underscore data, and dot just stands for the current directory. In this current directory, we want the data folder and the one country colors CSV. All right, let's look at this. And what we want to create from this is a named vector. We only want a vector of colors, but we want the names of the colors to be the country. So in order to do this, let me put this into a mutate. And now I want color to be equal to set names. And set names is like assigning something to names, except in one step. So we want a vector to name, which is going to be color, and the names are going to be country. And because we are inside mutate, it will know to look for those names in our country colors dataset. Now, to our eye, not much changed, but color now has names. And what we want to do is we don't actually want this in a data frame anymore. We want to pull one column out. So I use the function pull. I could have just assigned this to some variable and then used the dollar syntax, but I think it's nice to do everything in these steps. So pull is basically a pipeable dollar. So we can get one column out as a vector. And actually, let me remove this part. And now everything happens in one step. We read it in, then we muted it, and we pull out the color thing. And then if I only look at the first couple of elements, which is what the head function is for, there's head, there's also tail, but head only looks at the first couple of elements of a vector, so we don't overplot our whole screen. Now we have the country colors, and down here in our plot, what we want to do is change the way the colors are mapped to the country, and we do this by changing the scales. So we scale color manual. And scale color manual takes some values, and they will either be named in matched in order or by named, by names. So we have a named vector, we use this. And there's another argument I want to change in scale color manual, which is the guide. A guide is an abstract way of referring to something like a legend, a color bar, anything that explains our plot. And we do not want a legend for our colors because it will cover the whole plot. So what we say is guide. Is equal, well, now we need to give it some guide. So these functions start with guide, we can generate a guide specification, but we only want guide none, which is no guide. So now we get an error because apparently we didn't provide the country colors, which I assume is because we named our argument wrong. We need to actually tell it, okay, these are the values, and now it should work. And the nice thing about these country colors, which are provided, is that they sort of match within each continent. Let's do some more work to make it pretty. We can add a theme, let's say minimal, to this and add some labels. It should be fairly obvious that this is the year, so let's actually not label this. And why? We should give this a better name, like life expectancy at birth. And let's give it a title, change of over the years. One last thing. If we knit this, we of course get this whole document where we have all the plots, and we can copy these plots from there. But you will probably also want a way of saving a plot in your script to make it explicit and to use it somewhere else. So this modify plot, let me assign this back to it. So now we have this plot variable that we can use anytime to display a plot. We can also display the plot in our viewer, in our plots panel down here, to see how it looks, maybe bigger or and now I get an error, or a warning, because I did the things twice. I have the same plot variable that I overwrote. So let me create the original plot like it would happen in the normal order of execution. So now we can look at it again. You can also pop this out here to see how it looks when it's on a different scale. And now it needs to re-render and to adjust to the new size. Okay, but what we can do is save this plot. Let's use the function gg save, and it takes a file name, my plot, and it guesses the type from the extension, so let's make it a png plot and give it the plot variable. By default, it will take the size, so the width and the height, from the current active graphics device, which in this case is our output in the notebook. It could also be the output in here. But we could also specify the widths in some units. Now I've saved it. 7x7, 7 is actually in inches, which is some relic from print media. But now we have myplot.png in our files here. Notice some of the dips in the life expectancy lines for some countries. We will explore these rather bleak realities next week when we get into modeling. For now, I'll leave you with the exercises that you can find in the script, and I'll see you in the office hours. Bye.